So it took him over 18 years to create a 5,000 crore worth company, sheer perseverance to become the first ever gaming company in India to go public with an IPO, and massive amount of humility that keeps him grounded even after all this success. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome one of the biggest gaming veterans from India, a person that I personally admire a lot and is literally like a brother, like a big brother, keeps on advising on things. Founder and MD of Nazara Technologies, Mr. Nitish Mithrasen. Welcome, Nitish. I'm super thrilled and pleasure having you on the gaming podcast by Underdog.
Thank you, Vaibhav, and thank you for calling me here. Looking forward.
Great, great. So I need to begin this conversation by asking you, what was your motivation to get into gaming in an era where gaming was, very new? No one really believed in it.
Sure. So, I came from a textile family background. But my dad bought me a ZX Spectrum when I was 6. And I started coding games when I was 7 in basic language. So it became a passion for me very early on. I think gaming, computers, technology, of course, the internet wasn't there that time, but generally, I became a geek in that sense.
Right.
And that passion went on to later years in school. I was running a bulletin board service in my bedroom with when I was in 9th, 10th standard. I had 10, 12 computers crammed up in my bedroom, 20 MTNL telephone lines, 2400 BPS modems connected to it.
So the entrepreneurship is right from the beginning.
Then I was in college in Mumbai, thinking about doing an MBA when I, as a next step after my BCom.
Okay.
But then this whole dot-com boom was happening, 97, 98, 99.
Yeah.
I actually used to know Jerry Yang from Yahoo in the early years, in the early 90s.
Yeah.
And of course, Shami Kapoor was a mentor for me and very close to me also.
Correct.
So in that sense, I knew both the Mr. Yahoos. Right. And all of that kind of pushed me into doing something here. I still remember there was this big Yahoo launch that happened in India at the Taj Hotel.
Right.
And this was maybe 98 or 99. And I said, boss, I have to do something in this whole world of .com. And the closest thing I knew and the biggest passion I had was gaming.
Correct.
And that's how I started Nazara.com
in 99. But this is like you directly jump into this venture, Nazara. You didn't try anything else before gaming?
I mean, I was running a web design shop. This is a company called Internet 3000 Technologies.
Okay.
Now I don't even remember. I used to make some websites for a few companies. So I was, playing around and experimenting with what could be done.
Yeah.
Trying to find my own way into, something meaningful.
Correct.
Before I started this venture.
Got it. And this was which year?
I started Nazara in 99.
Got it. I think it was the same year when the other companies, like India Games and Dhruva, came in.
Yeah. I think so. My peers at that point of time was India Games, Vishal.
Right.
Rajesh at Dhruva, Alok at Contest.
Contest to Win, yeah.
Neeraj Roy at Hangama.
Correct. All the legendary.
We were all around that.
Nice. You definitely had a passion and perseverance to continue this until it succeeds. But did you ever imagine getting to this level when you started?
When I started, like I said, it was the peak of the dot-com boom.
Right.
And therefore, while the business itself that I was doing was barely anything, right?
Yeah.
Not even any monetization model.
Right.
But the dreams are very large.
Yeah.
And of course, we all learned our lessons during the dot-com crash.
Right.
Which happened thereafter, right?
Right.
But the best thing that happened to many of us in terms of teaching us some hard lessons at a young age.
Yeah.
Thereafter, of course, it was a long grind because gaming in India, as you know, took very long to take off.
Correct.
And for many, many years, it felt like this industry will take off, is not taking off, macro level issues,
right,
etc. But the good part is we managed to persevere.
Correct.
Or maybe we didn't know what else to do, so we persevered. But we are here today. Now, of course, it's a completely different world. I mean, you look at what's happening around us, right? We are speaking today right in the midst of the Zomato IPO.
Yeah.
Who would have imagined a food delivery app being worth 60,000 crores or whatever it is. So I think now from an Indian entrepreneurial perspective, no dream is too small. I think from a Lazada perspective, we have a long way to go.
Right.
And luckily, we got our IPO done in right time and, you know, successfully. I think it's a new beginning for us, and we should have, today if we don't dream big, it really will be our own fault, I would say.
Yeah. And I think it gave a lot of Indian gaming companies a big boost in terms of, you know, dreaming big. Obviously, a lot of companies aspire to be there, but fortunately, Nazara went to that road, and it's pretty damn good for everybody in the industry. You know, the industry knows you professionally, rather you as an entrepreneur, mostly, but only a few people know about your personal side, right? I would like to quickly tell the audience about my experience when I first met you. This was back in 2014. I don't know if you remember. I'm sure you might be meeting a lot of people every now and then. But this was back in 2014 when I came to Nazara to meet you, and I had nothing on the table to offer you. Just a noob guy with a 4-man studio, small studio, attempting to make games. Still, the way you treated me, gave your time, advised me on to the business side of it, was an absolute learning for me. You know, one more incident I remember, after a couple of meetings that we did, you called me at 11 in the morning. I was there around 10:50. Your meeting got stretched till 11:30, and I was still sitting in the lobby. This legend, ladies and gentlemen, left his meeting twice and checked on me in the lobby if I'm okay with waiting outside. You really didn't have to do that at all. But that's how humble Nitish Mittersen is. Nitish, I want to ask you, where does this humility comes from?
Very simple, it's directly come from my grandfather. My grandfather was a very eminent cardiologist.
Yeah.
Also the Padma Vibhushan, Dr. V.K. Goel. And I saw him from, you know, upfront, obviously, being my grandfather.
Yeah.
And he was such a large doctor. He was a doctor for the presidents of India, etc. But he would be so humble with everyone, right?
Right.
And I would often ask him that, how do you manage that?
Yeah.
That everyone is a patient for me, whether the president or you know, anyone else. And I just saw that, I just felt that kind of struck a chord to me. And I've always tried to practice as much as I can. Of course, we can't be perfect and we do make our mistakes.
Correct.
But I think humility is a very important factor in success, actually, because humility needs you to not have a very large ego. And I think in the years I've seen a lot of the challenges you face as a person,
right,
are largely not because of X person, Y person, Z event, but because of your ego.
Correct.
So if you can suppress your ego, and we are all human beings, we will have ego, right,
sometime
or other,
right,
not God, but if you can suppress it and minimize it, I think life is far more positive and far more easy. And the humility is actually an outcome of suppressing the ego. That's what I think.
Great insights. I mean, I've been learning from you a lot since the day I met you. And it surprises me every time. And this is not just me speaking. Everybody, I'm sure everybody in the industry, I've spoken to a lot of people. And it just comes out that this is how Nitish is. You know, you just ask him and he'll give you an answer or an advice or whatever he can from his side, plus being, you know, very humble on the on that side as well. You have been striving hard, striving smart to build a successful gaming brand, right, which Nazara is right now. Is it only about making good games, or is there something else to go this far?
I think besides the product, right, and besides making good games,
yeah,
that of course is probably a core part of the product offering. But I think a lot of the Nazara DNA has helped us sustain over a long period of time.
Right.
So one is really what happened is because of the .com crash that I spoke about earlier, right? By the time we kind of re-emerged from that in 2005, 2006, my thinking and my DNA, and therefore also it got translated into company's DNA, became very much about cash flows, profitability, and chasing tangible business.
Right.
Versus vanity metrics. Like, for example, how many downloads does a game have? Is it relevant, right?
Right.
How many active users do you have?
Right.
So I think that thinking became crystallized then. And that allowed us two things. One, to run very lean and mean operations at very low cost, with strong focus on how can we make profits, how we can generate business. So to give you an example, even today I don't have an EA, right? I do my own scheduling because I don't think it's necessary, especially with all the automation that is around today.
Right.
That was the basic core thinking of the company that allowed us to sustain for a long period of time with low cost when the business didn't exist.
Got it.
It's like if you live to fight another day, right?
Yeah.
Otherwise the battle is lost.
Correct.
So I think that perseverance or sustainability over a long period of time allowed us to at least stay alive.
Right.
The opportunity for the business started happening. And once we got onto that, for a few years, we created through our profits,
yeah,
a lot of reserves. So that we knew that we had enough cushion to take shocks and disruptions in the market. And that's how we think today also. If you look at the Nazara business today,
right,
it's diversified by product, it's diversified by geography, and therefore there's no single event that can destabilize the business.
Got it.
While that may not allow us to maximize focus and energy on one particular business, which also is not the best place to be, but at least it gives us a long-term sustainability.
Yeah.
To wait for the best opportunities and then deliver on it.
Right. And how important are the people that you work with? Like, because a founder having a dream is one thing, but convincing or inspiring others to follow your dreams is another. Nazara being such a big company now, any tips on that front, on the people side?
I think, if you're talking about people in terms of your own team, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, they are critical or the most critical aspect. But what I found over the years is that to attract good talent and also have them stay for long, right?
Right.
It's not really about, at least in our case, it has not really been about paying the largest packages or having the fanciest offices or offerings or perks, etc.
Yeah.
I think if you can just be transparent with your team, today we've got so many people here who, spent over a decade in Nazara still.
Yeah.
And they're like family. I think you can be like family to them.
Right.
On a smaller scale, operation is possible. If you have 5,000 people, it may not be possible. But in our case, we don't have 5,000 people. So
correct.
It is possible. I think transparency and good intent, positive intent with your team, is very important, and that's what's helped us be successful, because our team has been there for a long time and understand what we are doing and kind of buy the same dream that we are building for. Without that, it's not possible. No single person can do anything.
Yeah, absolutely, because not just you, but I know a lot of top level people at Nazara. I know them personally. I've been, you know it. Like, we've often chat on things, right? But the DNA that you mentioned earlier, you can see that DNA throughout these people as well. Like, the way you speak, it's the same thing which goes on with your legacy. Like, I can just call it as a legacy. Totally on point, agreed to it. Another thing I just wanted to touch base on, I've been doing regional theater for like over 10 years now, because I really believe in an ideology that, you must be connected to some sort of art form along with whatever you do professionally, because your work will help you live, but like by making money, obviously, but the art will teach you why to live. Right. So coming back to the personal side of Nitish Mithra Sen, tell me a bit about your interest in jazz music.
Yeah, sure. you know, I picked up the sax when I was about 18, 19, so actually very late to pick up an instrument in that sense.
Right.
But the brain wiring happens at a young age.
Yeah.
That's why how much ever I practice, I can't become a professional, right?
Yeah.
Because I picked it up late. But I was fascinated by the saxophone, actually, through this Maine Pyar Kiya song of Salman Khan many, many years back, which I would have seen when I was young in school, right?
Yeah.
Someday I want to learn the saxophone. That's how I picked it up.
Yeah.
Then, of course, the sir that I got was a very well-known jazz musician.
Okay.
Guyanese musician called Jazzy Joe. And that's how I kind of got introduced to the world of jazz.
Right.
Kind of fell in love with that. But yeah, I completely agree with you. I think any form of art or any hobby.
Yeah.
Basically, we as humans need to keep learning something new. Yeah.
Yeah.
To stagnate, right?
Yeah. But do you think this also changes you as a person, you know, in terms of thinking also and doing stuff? I think theater helped me a lot in terms of, you know, speaking, in terms of stage fear, in terms of networking or even storytelling in games. It helped me. Do you think these art forms really help you as a person to succeed in your professional life as well?
Yeah, I'm sure in a certain way. I mean, I've always found my music to be a big de-stressor for me.
Yeah.
Even now, I practice it at least once a week on the weekends or whenever. These days, I've been harassing all my Facebook and social media by putting up my.
No, I make sure I see that. Like I've been messaging you about that whenever I see something like that, because it's like very surprising for me to even, you know, because it's not any noob stuff that you do. It looks really pro, and I think it takes a lot of practice to get to where the kind of music that you play.
I think the best thing that jazz and the sax does is keep me stay close to the ground, you know, when I try and play difficult songs and realize my capabilities. I realize I have a long way to go.
Yeah, and you have posted a couple of videos where you also performed in front of public, right? Also, that is quite being grounded, right? Like, it's Nitish Mittersen performing for you, man.
My jazz band played for almost 20 years in most South Mumbai clubs.
Okay.
We played quite a bit.
Nice. So yeah, let's just talk about what the whole world is talking about right now, which is Nazara IPO. How was the journey towards getting to an IPO?
See, we decided to launch the IPO in 2017.
Yeah.
We attempted, it took us about 9 months to a year to get ready.
Right.
2018, we made our first attempt because of multiple reasons. It didn't happen then.
Mm-hmm.
We parked it for a while, and then we thought in 2020 we were kind of ready again.
Right.
So we actually planned to kickstart this somewhere in, I would say, mid of 2020.
Okay.
And I was right in the middle of COVID, actually. When we released, so this was one IPO that happened completely online. as we were calling it a Zoom IPO, you know.
Okay.
Everything was online, but this time around, because we had already done it once, the team was really geared up.
Right.
All our partners, the lawyers, the bankers, were really geared up. So we were all in sync of what needs to be done, and touch wood went very smoothly. It took us 6-7 months to execute it.
All right.
And finally, in March, we managed to do it.
Nice. Also, this strategy of, you know, you went very aggressive on building a great portfolio. Building the portfolio, how much did that help you getting to an IPO?
Of course, it helped us. Finally, it helped us scale our business numbers, profitability, and get into very important areas. Like esports or gamified learning, the future was. I think what we realized was at the pace of growth that this market is going to give us over the next decade.
Right.
Today at Nazara, we can sit and start new businesses, spend the next few years building them from zero to one.
Right.
but that's going to be very time consuming.
Correct.
The market will grow much faster than we don't have that time anymore what we had in the past.
Right.
So that was where this whole concept of Friends of Nazara was born, where we said, let us partner with passionate founders and management teams.
Right.
Let's go onto the same platform, pursue the same dream, and let's create value together. I think that model in the last 3-4 years has really, picked up.
Yeah.
We've also learned along the way, and we are only going to accelerate it a lot more going forward.
Got it. So you still have plans to, you know, get more companies in the portfolio in the coming years?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And what is the next hot category that you feel, you know, because Nazara was never into esports or the other
learning stuff,
but that you have already covered. What do you think more is still to be, you know,
I think we'll continue to build out the current product stacks. So for example, the gamified learning, today we have a product which caters to 2 to 7 year old kids.
Yeah.
But there's a space open for 8 to 12. So we are now actually actively looking for a company
mm-hmm.
that is servicing that category.
Got it.
Fill that stack. Similarly, within the esports vertical, I think there are many other niches of esports that we can fill. As you saw, we did the Sportskeeda acquisition.
Yeah.
Now they've pivoted to esports with over 25 million users coming every month for esports content alone on Sportskeeda.
Right.
We have not been here, Sportskeeda. We may find another company there.
Right.
The freemium space is something we are today, I would say, relatively small in, right? We only have World Cricket Championship.
Yeah.
The key part of that portfolio.
Right.
We are very actively looking for companies in the freemium space, either targeting the Indian market or even global markets. I think there's huge opportunities there.
Correct.
We will look at building that stack out. So I think we want to currently, rather than opening up new fronts, at least for this year,
yeah,
but a lot of our focus is to kind of build out the existing product verticals.
Got it.
And scale them a lot larger than what they are before we find new categories.
Got it. So apart from the filling the gaps, what is it that you personally look into the companies or the founders? Because I mean, I'm sure for one specific loophole, you might have an option for 4-5 companies which you can, you know, have similar numbers. But what is it that gives you a good confidence?
Yeah, I think we are really looking for companies that have moved ahead of the 0 to 1 stage.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We are looking for companies that already have a product market fit
mm-hmm.
And can, you know, come onto our platform and get scaled very fast.
Got it.
I think so. That's one thing that we're looking for.
Okay.
The second, of course, is broadly the DNA matches, right? They said for us, for example, chasing vanity metrics is something we don't like at all. So let's say if a team comes in and says, you know, my game has 1 million downloads.
Yeah.
Then that really sets the wrong tone for us.
Correct.
Because so we just look for similar DNA.
Mm-hmm.
Focus on serious, tangible businesses, and that can add some synergy now or later to our overall ecosystem.
Right. You mentioned that Sportskeeda pivoted, right? They pivoted the business to esports. Now a lot of people don't really get the concept of pivoting. From your point of view, can you just tell me, you know, why pivoting in a startup seems necessary? This is like a generic question that I wanted to understand.
It's a nature of evolution, right?
Right.
You have to evolve to survive. As simple as that. It's been there for millions of years, whether it's a startup or a human being or anyone, right? You have to evolve with what the environment demands of you. And specifically with Sportskeeda, I think it was not so much a pivot.
Because right.
Sportskeeda was already a multi-sports content destination.
Yeah.
And news destination, right?
Right. Right.
Sports is a new sport.
Yeah.
Added esports. I would not say it's a pivot.
Yeah.
It's just an extension of what, it was an obvious extension of what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
But the esports content, they've kind of quickly moved to becoming a leader.
Yeah.
that kind of also plays out very well with our overall esports strategy.
Yeah.
So it kind of worked out well that way.
Yeah, the other day I saw the ranking that you posted, and it's pretty great. Good job by the team. But did you ever, like, in during the Nazara journey, did you do any kind of pivots?
I probably lost count of how many times. Right. Yeah, still. So.
Yeah, so that explains everything, I think. Okay, last couple of questions before we can conclude, right? The pandemics have changed a lot, right? The world, how the world operates. How important is it now for gaming studios to continue working like before, or even remote work in the future? You know, can gaming companies survive working remotely, do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we've worked remotely for 2 years, right?
Yeah.
I said we did the whole IPO remotely. So, an IPO in India is not so easy.
You're just setting the bars really high. What about work? We are doing an IPO remotely.
No, I think there's so much we've seen in the last 2 years.
Yeah.
In terms of the benefits of flexible working, remote working, I think for each company has to find its own balance, mm-hmm. of what works best for them.
Right.
I'm imagining eventually it will be some form of hybrid working. You know, some giving some flexibility of remote work. Like we are in Nazara thinking maybe, you know, having a hybrid model, for example, so that we can get best of both worlds. Because it's not that in-office working also comes with some advantages.
Correct.
I've experienced so much advantages of remote working over the last 2 years.
Yeah.
And I don't think at least we will go back to completely traditional way of working.
Right.
To that extent, I think the pandemic, you know, for all its, you know, unfortunate situations.
Right.
When it comes to at least a way of working, has had a positive impact in the way all of us think. And for gaming companies, tech companies, software companies, virtual products, right? Not being able to work remotely doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Totally. Nazara has been like a mobile platform always, right? Like you've been working on mobile specifically. In general, what do you think in India about the PC and console category? Do you think it would work, or what is the stage?
Look, things have moved too far. The technology is converging. So today, the mobile phones have become so good, the 5-6 thousand Android device,
right,
that the need for high-end consoles has dropped significantly.
Correct.
So I think they will remain a niche market. I think India is going to remain a mobile-first gaming market.
Right.
And the devices will continue to get, you know, better and better, faster, cheaper, better experience.
Correct.
So I'm not too sure how large the PC or console gaming market is going to be vis-a-vis mobile. So at least our focus remains in this segment.
In the mobile, not in PC and consoles. Yeah. All right. Got it. Awesome. It was super, super useful, super insightful, Nitish. Thanks a lot for joining in. Before we conclude, I just want you to give some advice to, you know, fellow startups who are just venturing into building gaming businesses or even aspire to do so.
Yeah. No, I think more of what I already said. You know, focus on your key product KPIs. Don't get carried away by the hype, and don't chase vanity metrics. See yourself in the mirror every day and see the truth, and that will guide you to success.
Right. Stay grounded as well, right?
Each his own.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, Nitish, for the time. I hope this would be a great video for people to watch and learn some stuff.
Thank you. See you.
Bye bye.